Sian, and they've said that they think standing here would be the most effective place to speak to us all. I hope you agree. Do reposition yourselves if you think you need to be somewhere else in order to enjoy the event. So, I'm Poppy, and I'm very, very happy to welcome you all here. Others might be coming along, but it's a quarter to, so I thought it would be a good time to launch. Now we have the coffee machine going. It's like a tease, you know, I'm just about to go and it starts again. I'm really, really proud today to be able to welcome you and to be staging this event about a topic which, when asked, the London membership said was the most important, that they thought was the most important for this campaign, i.e. air quality in London. And we have quite distinguished speakers here today. Again, I'm very proud to say that. Not only we have the Green candidate for Mayor Sian Berry, who's going to go second after Stephen speaks. She is our candidate for Mayor. That's for Obi, isn't it? Yeah. She's also a councillor in Camden and a long-time transport campaigner who knows this issue inside out. We obviously have Stephen Taylor as well, who's standing for Camden and Barnet constituency for the Green Party. And Rosalind Redhead, who is standing for Mayor under the banner of no ban private cars in central London. So we have a lot of expertise in the room. And I'm looking, and the speakers have already told me that they're looking forward to a lively discussion after they have had their say. I think one of the most important aspects of... Yeah, thank you, Helen.
I can't do drinks without making a noise, I'm sorry.
Helen as well is the leading campaigner in Barnet on parking, so we are privileged to have be in this space with one of the most notorious women in Barnet. Before I hand over to Stephen, I wanted to spend a bit of time telling you about the car crisis report, which I published last month. This is a report, I'm holding it up here, of the proceedings of a summit which I convened last year called How to Solve Barnet's Car Crisis. This is before I was introduced to the concept of peak car, which Rosalind introduced me to today. But it was just my observations that the pressure of cars on our roads was causing ever more social complaint, social unrest. And I was very struck by the piecemeal response that Barnet Council appeared to be giving to this problem. So I convened a meeting where we did not discuss the problem. We only discussed solutions to the problem. And I published the proceedings of the suggested solutions last month, which the paper gave to the chair of the Environment Committee of Barnet Council to say, look, your constituents have come up with this, what do you think? He dismissed it as pie in the sky, even though most of the measures in here are being implemented somewhere on this earth, not in the sky. And I thank Phil for that line. Today, I got an email from someone in Barnet Council, not an elected councillor, but an official, asking me for a link to this report and telling me he'll be in touch with me about it afterwards. So we can see that there are strings being pulled in various directions. I also want to pay tribute to a friend of Nick's, whom I also know. His name is Aidan, and he died about 13 months ago of lung cancer, even though he had never smoked in his life, but had driven a bus through central London for 20 years. And he was a very dear and lovely man, and it makes me cry every time I think about him. But when we speak about air pollution, we are not talking about an abstract problem. We are talking about a real issue that affects some of us very deeply. And on that, this report, by the way, is available for sale if anybody wants it, and it's online. Stephen, if you are ready, I will hand over to you now.
Thank you very much. If I park myself up here, can you all see me? Can you hear me? Yeah, you're across this way. Can you hear me over there? Okay, that's a start. Well, Sean and I seem to be slowly starting to evolve a double act in which I talk about problems and she talks about solutions, which suits my gloomy nature. And that's what we'll be doing this evening. I was opened up by talking about pollution. And there's nothing very new to London about pollution. There are written complaints about London's filthy air going back to the 14th century. In those days, the problem was lignite, brown coal, very smoky when it burns. And I didn't think about this until a couple of years ago, but the whole geography of London is given by air pollution, water pollution. All the posh suburbs are upwind, basically. Basic geography of inner London. And the effluent draining from London's gutters into the ditches and the and London's rivers created a background stink for London, which rose in the summer and fell in the winter, but was kind of an inevitable urbanity, shall we say. It just seems to be part of city living and inescapable. As an example, the Fleet River, which rises on Hampstead Heath just south of here and flows down through Kentish Town and into the River Thames. In Roman times, that was 600 feet wide where it hit the Thames. After the Great Fire of London, Wren built quays and custom house along the estuary of the Fleet River. Big deal, it was navigable as far up at least as Kentish Town. That slowly over the centuries turned into a sewer contributing to the general pond throughout London. And when nobody showed much enthusiasm for paying the customs dues in the late 17th century, it got completely roofed over, the customs house pulled down, and it became one of London's several buried rivers. Something I find quite fascinating, the idea that underneath our city we've got buried rivers. And there it lay quietly contributing to the pond, which everybody regretted, but it was of course one of those things you couldn't do anything about until the summer of 1858. Where July and August were particularly warm, and Parliament couldn't sit. They dipped the curtains of the Palace of Westminster in lime chloride to combat the pond and the pestilence, and they still couldn't sit. And at that point, something had to be done. And they engaged an engineer, Joseph Bazalgette, and he designed and implemented the northern and southern outfalls. Sewage lines. Do you know what's there? Perhaps you don't. Sewage lines which run downstream from London, intercepting all the buried rivers and taking the sewage south for processing somewhere out to the east where property prices are low. So it's a nice example of a kind of pollution that was you couldn't do anything about, you just had to put up with it until suddenly something has to be done, and it turned out something could be done, and it was done, and it got sorted. The city's air might seem to be harder to treat if you can't channel it into sewers. When I was 3 months old, in December 1952, London had its worst air pollution incident in its recorded history, the Great Smog of 1952. At the time, the epidemiologists calculated that it caused 4,000 deaths in a period of a few weeks. Once again, something which was just a part of London's famous pea soupers turned into something that had to be done about it. And the Clean Air Act 1956 was passed. And over the following years, coal disappeared from domestic hearths. I can still remember walking London streets when the background smell was coal smoke. When I occasionally smell it these days, it's a little bit nostalgic twinge. It takes me back to my boyhood. And what you would not guess from looking at the period TV dramas from this, allegedly set in the 1950s, is that pretty much every exterior wall in London was black with soot. They looked so much smarter on the TV these days. We now face a greater crisis. Pollutants this time are nitrogen dioxide and particulate matter. Fine particulate matter. They're invisible, but they are far more dangerous even than the soot particles of the Great London Peace Soakers. This is what you'll find if you read Wikipedia about particulate matter. The World Health Organization designates airborne particulates a group 1 carcinogen. Particulates are the deadliest form of air pollution due to their ability to penetrate deep into the lungs and bloodstream, unfiltered, causing permanent DNA mutations, heart attacks, and premature death. In 2013, a study involving over 3,000 people in 9 European countries showed that there is no safe level of particulates, and that every increase to 10 micrograms a cubic meter of lung cancer rate rose 22%. The smaller particles, as PM10, 10 microns and below, and PM25, which is 2.5 microns or below, were particularly deadly, with a 36% increase in lung cancer rate per 10 microgram rise as it can penetrate deeper into the lungs. I reminded you of your friend of 20 years driving through central London. Public Health England calculates that in 2010, long-term exposure to PM25 was responsible for 6.8% of all deaths that year, or contributed to 6.8% of all deaths that year in Barnet. Another way of looking at the same statistics is that for those of us living long-term in London, air pollution effects shorten our lives by 11 to 12 years. I told that to a friend of mine who lives up in the Swiss mountains, an English friend, moved there a quarter of a century ago, and he said, so does that mean if you move outside London, you live an extra 10 years, or does it just feel like it? King's College London calculates the combined effect of NO2 and particulate matter kills 9,500 Londoners every year. Perspective, that is more than double the mortality that prompted the Clean Air Act 1956. We have more than enough reason to act, and the Clean Air Act was dramatic. It basically said to everybody who was heating their home with coal, which was pretty much everybody, as central heating had scarcely made an appearance in Britain, at least not since Roman times. It basically said to everybody, you are going to shut down your fireplace and your kitchen and the fires in them and replace them with something else, gas, electricity. Obviously an impossible thing to do, but we did it. And I invite you to contemplate what kind of consequences would follow if terrorists are killing 9,500 Londoners every year.
Sorry.
Nearly half the nitrogen dioxide in Camden comes from vehicle engines and from diesel engines in particular. Although they've been promoted in the last decade for their clean green credentials because they produce less carbon dioxide than petrol engines, diesel engines produce 17 times as much nitrogen dioxide as petrol engines. Sort of an unfortunate oversight, or so it would seem. There's been, as you probably know, a big program over the last decade to replace petrol engines with diesel engines, and that has had the wholehearted support of the motor industry, to nobody's surprise. But it has emerged recently that Whitehall knew about the nitrogen dioxide emissions as far back as 2003, which must be people asking themselves, in whose interests are we being governed? Another 40% of the nitrogen dioxide comes from burning gas as a fuel without equally divided between domestic and commercial boilers. And rail transport accounts for nearly all the rest. So there's clearly a big opportunity there for reducing the nitrogen dioxide emissions by improving domestic boilers and by reducing the need for them with better insulation, simple measures that the Greens have been calling for about 400 years. Three quarters of the particulate matter, particularly dangerous particulate matter, remember, comes from transport. 80% of that from road transport. 40% of the PM10 emissions, we don't have these figures for the more deadly, smaller 2.5. 40% of those comes from brake and tire wear. So even electric vehicles pollute and contribute to this. So, what does the law say about this? That's spot on. Bless you. European Directive 2008/50 EC, if you like to quote these things, sets maximum exposures to these poisons. And it's worth reflecting that the law matters most particularly to those of us who don't have many choices about where we live and work. The limits are set for NO2 at what the World Health Organization recommends. Bearing in mind there isn't a safe limit, they just said, stop worrying over this level. To be more accurate, they said, and go quarter after this level. And that level is 40 micrograms per cubic meter per year, over a 1 year exposure. That, of course, is going to conceal a lot of short-term variations. For the short-term variations, it can go as high as 200 for an hour. And it can do that 18 times in a year. At 200 micrograms, the World Health Organization describes NO2 as a toxic gas. This stuff turns to nitric acid in your lungs, which inflames the lung tissues, brings on asthma and heart attacks. London used up its 18 breaches by nitrogen dioxide in the first 8 days of this year. I think one of the notorious spots is Putney High Street, where the street architecture and the heavy heavy traffic of buses particularly, which are overlarge contributor to the nitrogen dioxide, concentrates the whole thing. But there are streets in central London, such as Marylebone Road and parts of Oxford Street, which are running annual averages of 145 and 120 respectively. So those are figures which are starting to approach toxic gas level as an annual average. God knows
Marylebone
Road. Marylebone Road was the first 145. You can spot these things on communitymaps.org. For particulate matter, the EU specifies limits which are in effect double the World Health Organization guidelines. And for particulate, for the larger PM10, they set a limit of 40 micrograms as an annual exposure and 50 for a 24-hour surge, and then 35 breaches in a year. Alarmingly, the most dangerous PM25 ultrafine particles, the ones that go worm their way straight into the lungs and the bloodstream, they set that limit as twice what the World Health Organization suggests, and they set no limit on the number of short-term breaches that are allowed. These figures conceal a lot of local differences. If you look at a map of London where the where the particulate matter and the NO2 exposures are, you see most of London's PM10 exposure is well below 20. The concentrations where the poisonous air is kind of picks out the road network, again, unsurprisingly. If you look at the nitrogen dioxide, it's a different matter. The centre of the city is bathed in dangerous levels of nitrogen dioxide, again with the concentrations along the road network. But if you're sitting in Barnet, you might think, well, if I'm away from a roadside, I'm probably doing all right on particulate matter, but I've got levels of nitrogen dioxide which should be of concern to me. The effects of these poisons on children are particularly worrying. Let me read from the Sunday Times here. The data shows that traffic pollution stops children's lungs growing properly, said Ian Mudway, a respiratory toxicologist at King's College. The evidence suggests that by 8 or 9 years old, children from the most polluted areas have 5 to 10% less lung capacity, and they may never get that back. London children growing up with smaller lungs as a result of the poisoned air here. Clean Air in London found over 1,000 schools in London within 150 metres of roads carrying 10,000 plus vehicles a day, and a total of 2,270 schools within 400 metres of such roads. This next bit's not going to comfort you very much, but I live in Hampstead. Hampstead has spared the worst of London's poisoned air. Probably in a comparable position here at Barnet, just by being further out. Where I live, the Hampstead Neighbourhood Forum recently conducted a survey of the local NO2 levels, and somebody here wants to do it the same.
Yes.
Oh, okay, we'll have a word afterwards.
Okay, yeah. Okay.
It's a simple exercise. We followed Sian's lead 2 years ago in Dartmouth Park. And we're working in parallel with green groups in Gospel Oak and Kentish Town and another neighbourhood forum in Reddington Frog. So we've got quite a good swathe of readings across central Camden. We measured mean annual nitrogen dioxide levels at 30 sites across the Hampstead Forum area. The lowest level was recorded, unsurprisingly, at the viaduct pond, right in the middle of Hampstead Heath. We wanted this as a reference level. High above London, behind a hill, sheltered by woodland, far from roads, and with the prevailing winds coming not out of the city, but from upwind of it. So you couldn't expect a lower reading anywhere else in London. You might reasonably take this as kind of a background level of nitrogen dioxide level, as you might look for a background radiation level from the earth. We recorded 20 micrograms per cubic meter, a full 50% of the legal limit. And I remind you once again that the doctors tell us that there is no safe level, there is no level of nitrogen dioxide exposure which does not cause harm. Elsewhere in the area, we found 30 to 40 micrograms on the residential roads and up to 70 micrograms on our main roads. As many of our residents suspected, while the air in Hampstead is better than in the centre, it still carries dangerous levels of poisons. and I'd suggest that in Barnet you're probably in much the same situation, possibly a little better further in the residential roads, being further out from central London, and a little worse on the main roads, because your main roads are bigger and I suspect busier than ours. Well, that's the gloomy news. So if I hand over to here, over you here,
sure.
What we might tell about this.
Okay.
Well, thank you for that introduction. That was a really
scary.
Brilliant. I mean, yeah, really setting out very, very clearly all the issues that there are with our city. But also talking a little bit about the brilliant work you've been doing in Hampstead. A bit more on my background. My job until recently has been the transport campaigner. I was working for Campaign for Better Transport, trying to stop new roads being built and roads being widened. And as you can imagine, air pollution has been a very, very strong argument against increasing the size of roads that I've been using. I've been part of and sat on the board of the Healthy Air campaign, and they are an offshoot of Client Earth, who are the people who've been taking the UK government to the Supreme Court, establishing the legal basis for the government having to redo all its air pollution plans at the moment. They've done a fantastic job, and the Healthy Air campaign is the kind of campaigning wing of that. I've been working with Ian Mudway and Frank Kelly, and Ian's absolutely amazing, because not only is he doing research on all these children in Tower Hamlets and Newham and finding out all these results, he's going out and speaking at public meeting after public meeting, showing the size of the black carbon that he's found inside those children's lungs, showing the results of the exposure tests he's been doing, talking about how their lungs are being made smaller by the air pollution. And this is a permanent problem. Once your lungs are smaller when you're growing up, they don't reach their full size. So when you get older and you're challenged by things like air pollution, things like diseases, you're much, much more likely to succumb to those diseases. So it's a lifelong draw on your health if you grow up with stunted lungs. And this is happening to hundreds of thousands of children in Tower Hamlets and Newham. He makes the point, he zooms in on the map, and I should have brought my iPad with me, but my iPad has on it the map of air pollution in London. If you zoom in on Newham and Tower Hamlets, you can see basically the whole place is swimming in yellow, and yellow is where the legal limit comes in, according to the colour-coded map I have. And you can see that basically you can't live away from the legal limits, you can't travel to school, you can't be at school and be above the legal limits, so that's horrible. But I'm especially talking about solutions. So, let me carry on with that.
Did you miss the website where you can see this map?
Send
it to me, Sean, and I'll circulate.
It's not a web, it's a report. Okay. It's in the... Camden has a copy of it in the air quality plan. I mean, TfL have it in their proposals for the ultra low emission zone. It's a map that's been produced. It's a model of how much air pollution there is. And the thing about that is, the model is not entirely correct, because if you go out, it's modelled on, you know, assumptions about air pollution from traffic levels. A lot of it's slight guesswork. I mean, you know, intelligent guesswork, but guesswork. So the work that we've been doing in Camden, the work that Greens are doing all around the country as well, as but all around London, to measure the air pollution actually in situ during certain weeks and putting that information out to people is absolutely vital. It shows you exactly what it is. So you look at the model for my street and it looks like it might be 50 or 55. Twice now, on the corner where I live, in Tufnell Park, we've measured above 70 doing these system science studies. So it shows that the model is not quite as fine-grained and accurate as you'd like, and having the information from system science is great. So the first solution I want to talk about is information and awareness. I think it's really important that people do experiments, people do communicate, have public meetings like this to talk about how bad the air is and why it's a problem. I think there's a lot of assumptions out there that it's just central London and therefore in Leafy Highgate we're going to be okay. It's exactly what we didn't find in Leafy Highgate when we did the studies. It's exactly what we didn't find in Leafy Hampstead when we did the studies. You know, nowhere in London really escapes these illegal air pollution levels. We've got an issue like around the country as well. A lot of people around the country are assuming that this is a London problem. And actually, air pollution is just as bad in the centre of Bristol. It's really just as bad in the middle of Birmingham. It's
awful in the middle of Manchester. You know, we have just as much of a problem in other cities too. I'm running for Mayor of London, so talking about what the Mayor of London can do is important. In terms of information from the Mayor of London, what we get at the moment is there's a website and a web service where you can go and look up the air pollution forecast for the day. When it reaches moderate, which means way above the legal limit, or high, which means dangerously above the legal limit, people really, when they've got medical conditions, when they're unwell or unfit or elderly, really should be staying away from places that have lots of traffic and high levels of pollution. When it's high, that is properly a danger sign. The Mayor of London should be warning people about this. And it shouldn't just be warning people that the air's bad, it should be warning the drivers not to come in. It's very important that when we know there's air pollution coming, and sometimes the air pollution is blowing over from Europe because all the cars in Europe are putting out nitrogen dioxide and the weather bring it over and have it settle over London a bit. But when that's happening, we shouldn't be making the problem worse by driving into London. So the Mayor of London needs to get a grip on this and start warning people that the air is bad for their health on particular days, and warning drivers to not make the problem worse. The Mayor ought to also have some kind of provision in place to actually prevent some of the drivers from coming in. This is what they do in China. This is what they've been doing in Paris recently, because Paris has had similar smogs to what we've had. And what they do there is they say, right, even numbered cars, you're not allowed in today. So if you've got an odd, even numbered car, you've got to go and find a friend who's got an odd number car to give you a lift. And that automatically halves the number of cars coming into the city. It's not that draconian a measure. There's still public transport on the roads and everything like that. But it's something that really makes a difference. I think the Mayor ought to be able to do that. So that's information and awareness. The second thing you should be doing is absolutely not making the problem worse. We have a legal obligation, this is what the client Earth have managed to establish, to bring air pollution down within legal limits as soon as possible. That's what the directive says, as soon as possible. Once we've not made the target of bringing it below the levels in 2010, our next legal obligation is to do it as soon as possible. So the first thing you do is not actually add more pollution by agreeing to things like expanding the M4, agreeing to things like a giant cruise ship terminal in Greenwich, in which great big enormous cruise ships that run off diesel are going to park there, run their diesel engines to get their electricity going for all their casinos and balls, and I don't know what happens on cruise ships, but whatever happens on cruise ships, they're not being provided with an electricity connection, which means they could potentially just plug in and not run their diesel engines. They're going to run diesel engines right in the middle of Greenwich, which is appallingly polluted, and that's dreadful. You wouldn't also build a new six-lane motorway over the Thames, either down at Dartford, which is the Dartford crossing, Highways England wants to build a new crossing there, or at Belvedere, which is the next one along, or at Silvertown, which is the one they want to build now. They want to build a tunnel now along where the Blackwall Tunnel is. And that would increase traffic across a wide area, including into Newmanshire Hamlets, which is where Ian Mudway is doing his studies. So you don't do any of that, and that's really important. So as Mayor, I would just cancel those schemes and put the money that would have gone into those schemes into better things. And the better things are, I mean, it seems obvious, but reducing traffic is like the big thing. And people always think, oh, air pollution, we must change the vehicles that there are. And we must, you know, we have to be putting the congestion charge up higher for diesel vehicles. We've been giving a discount based on CO2 levels for a while now. Quite a few diesel vehicles come under the level of CO2, and this has been cancelled by Boris recently, actually, but they've come under this level of CO2, so they were getting in for free, when actually we know now that their manufacturers were lying through their teeth about how much nitrogen dioxide they were putting out. So we've been allowing polluting vehicles into London for no money for quite a long time. So we have to be pushing up the charges for diesel vehicles quite dramatically and quite quickly, and that'll give a really strong incentive for people to shift. I mean, if you've got a diesel car, you're not being that draconian to say what you need to do is shift to a petrol car. And that will be, what is it, 17 times you worked out on average? About 17 times cleaner. So you've got to do some immediate measures like that. But reducing traffic is absolutely vital too. The congestion charge that we have covers a tiny, tiny area of central London, and it's 12 years old. And the amount that the congestion charge has gone up since 2008 is nowhere near the amount that bus fares have gone up since 2008. So what we would do immediately is write that wrong, so put them up by the amount that bus fares have gone up plus some for diesel cars, for all the cars, and then add some on for diesel as well, so that we're absolutely discouraging all cars from coming in central London again. We also have to replace the congestion charge. It's old. We need something that covers all of London. We need something that reduces traffic on streets like this, on the Holloway Road, where I was stuck in traffic all the way here. We need something to replace that. We need to replace the ultra low emission zone. Hands up if you know anything about the ultra low emission zone. Okay, brilliant. So that's something that TfL, Transport for London, decided what to do about sort of last year. And they put out a consultation saying, should it cover the whole of London? Should it include these vehicles or not? What should it cost if you're going to come in a vehicle that isn't compliant with the standards, all that sort of thing. We being all the transport campaigners and all the green parties and everything, fed back into that consultation and said, well, it has to cover the whole of London. It has to be much higher as a charge. It has to have a much higher increase. We can't just rely on these standards. These standards are dodgy. We've known this for years. It has to be for all diesel vehicles. They didn't listen at all, mainly because they didn't want the expense of moving like their cameras, because the cameras are currently set up around the current congestion charge zone. So the ULAS, which is what we all call it, that's how it could end up being named, is going to be just the congestion charge zone. It's going to be just from 2020. It's going to just charge £12.50 to come in. It's basically not going to have any effect. So this is an illegal scheme now. It's not solving the problem as soon as possible. So we have to replace that as well. And my plan as mayor would be to start consulting from May the 5th, after the election, on a new scheme. So say to people, what should we do? We need to cover the whole of London. We need to have a replacement for the ULEZ that's actually effective. We need to be reducing traffic. Shall we make this one scheme? How much should we charge? What vehicles should we exclude? And it's quite a complicated thing. And I think asking people, first of all, what should we do, is a really good idea. And I'm really heartened by Poppy's report, because it does show that people in outer London want this. And Rosalind's brought a copy of the Evening Standard from a few days ago.
Yesterday,
this is actually tonight. Oh, is it tonight? Because my time's going by. Okay. So yeah, there's a survey been done by London First, who are the organisation for the really big businesses in London, who are quite keen to make sure that we do something that covers the whole of London, that reduces congestion, because it's bad for their business, and they don't like the fact that they're having trouble recruiting people to work in London for a number of reasons. Air pollution is one of them. People don't want to come and bring up their children in our filthy air. So we've got an opening here. We can do this. It is popular. It won't be beyond the pale in the London and all those things that people warn you about. And I think we go out and consult people on the scheme from the beginning of the next mayoralty. We'll be able to bring something in by 2019 at the latest. I think that'll be really, really good. And we can do more in the central London zone where we've already got the infrastructure set up straight away. The other thing is vehicles. We have to start with our own vehicles. Diesel is the killer, and so many of our buses are still diesel. And there's a reason why we've taken so long. One of the reasons is because Boris has spent an awful lot of money, an awful lot of development money, and an awful lot of new bus money on the delightful new bus for London, which is hugely expensive for a bus. And isn't as clean as they said it was going to be, sucked up a load of money. We could have brought so many regulation hybrids that are clean for the money that we spent on that bus, and it's not achieving its own air pollution standards. And that's a real, real shame. So the Greens, in the budget this year, last week, they put forward an amendment to put the congestion charge up, and to keep to put council tax up as well, and to use that money to spend on cleaner buses. And get all the buses clean and on hybrid or electric by 2018 at the latest. And that's very realistic. The buses can keep up with manufacturing. We can also, once we own the copyright back, because for some reason we don't currently own the copyright on that new bus either. We've got to buy 1,000 buses from the company before we own the copyright. We'll have done that quite soon. We've got about 800 at the moment. And it is worth getting the copyright back. And once we've got it, we can develop our own version, which would be great. So we can go and replace the engine. We can do much more to make them wheelchair accessible and fit on more than one wheelchair and more than one buggy, so that mums and wheelchair users don't have to have a fight. And we can design like longer versions. We can design a bendy version. Don't call that. But you know what I mean. We will have the copyright back. We can go and design our own super clean buses for London. And I think that will be exciting. The other thing that we can do, and this is something I put forward in Camden, or I'm back to put forward in Camden's budget, and I put forward in Camden's budget last year, is charge more for residents parking when they're diesel vehicles. Now, one of the really interesting things about Poppy's report is that Barnet is not very well covered with controlled parking zones already. And this is one of the first things you do when you want to reduce traffic, is give people an incentive to not park and not drive in your borough. And I think that's be really important if you did that. And once you do that, you can charge more for diesel vehicles. And so in Camden, I'm going to be putting forward an increase in diesel vehicle charge for resident parking. And every borough in London can do this. I know Caroline and Islington has been putting it forward. She's been having some resistance from the other councillors in Islington. But it's absolutely vital. And every councillor in London can contribute that way towards reducing it. And then we've got investment in the alternatives. You know, I'm just talking about like reducing the vehicles, but you've got to give people alternatives of ways to get around. And that does mean investing in more public transport infrastructure, new tube lines, new trams, new buses. Particularly, I think buses and trams and tubes and rails go do the orbital routes that take you from town centre to town centre in outer London. This has been an ongoing problem for many years. If you look at some of the journeys that take place in outer London, those are the ones that really, really need to be switched to public transport. And those we can do some work on again, because it's probably a nut that's never been cracked. And Transport for London are going to need some of those routes to be subsidised. They're not going to be immediately commercially viable, but if we subsidise them, get them going and make them reliable, eventually people will come and use them, and then they'll be able to pay for themselves. And walking and cycling investment is really, really important too. This can be controversial, which is why having meetings, having air pollution studies, all of these things that generate the desire amongst local people to have less traffic, to reduce the effects of traffic on their children is really, really important. Because it gives you then permission to do things like traffic calm local neighbourhoods, things that are happening in Waltham Forest, which are controversial. At least in Waltham Forest, there was a really high vocal group of people, probably a majority of people, who were out there campaigning for the Mini Holland, for the traffic calming, for the best town centre, as well as people out there going, no, I want to drive everywhere, it's right there. And like shopkeepers who think that the people who come to their shops are all coming by car, when actually, when you've got a traffic calmed area, shops are much nicer to visit, people spend longer there and spend more money there, and there's really strong evidence about this, but shopkeepers don't believe you. And the final thing is that we need to deal with boilers. As you were saying before, you know, like the Clean Air Act before us, you know, we still have a lot of gas boilers in our homes, and a lot of them are very, very inefficient and putting a lot of nitrogen dioxide into the air. It's about 30% of our nitrogen dioxide comes from heating and boilers and boiler scrappage schemes and things like that. Other things like campaign for in the past are really important too, so we mustn't forget that. And insulating as well. There is one more thing I want to talk about, and that's the workplace parking levy. And has anyone ever heard of one of those?
Sorry?
Workplace parking levy. Yeah, so it's something that they have in Nottingham. It's something that's in legislation. We're allowed to do it in London without any new legislation. It means that if we started to consult on one later this year, we could get one in by 2018. And that's just a nice thing. It's an annual license fee that people who have workplaces where people can park when they drive to work. So we're not talking about vehicles that you use in the course of your business, we're talking about people driving into work, commuting parking spaces. You can get them to pay a license fee for that. And that's a really good incentive for workplaces to do the sort of simple, soft measures that you can do with your workforce, encouraging them to share lifts, giving them incentives to use the bike purchase scheme, or giving them loans to get travel cards instead, because the payment is made by the employer, and the encouragement is to retire those parking spaces. And I'll be announcing plans for that in a few weeks' time. And in it, seats. This is my little version of it online. In it, there's a load of information that comes from the census that shows you how many people are driving to work within boroughs, between boroughs, from out of London into each borough. It's really, really interesting. I just wanted to give you one fact from that in preparation. So in Barnet, there are currently 89,000 people who drive to work, to workplaces in Barnet. And about 48,000 of them come by car. So that's 53% of people who come to workplaces in Barnet come by car. So that's quite a lot. In Camden, we have 250,000 people who come to workplaces in Camden, and 23,000 of them come to work by car. Now that is 9%. So the difference between Barnet and Camden in terms of workplace driving is absolutely enormous. And so commuter driving is one thing that you could tackle. There's got to be, within that 47,700 people who are driving to work in Barnet, there must be some really soft targets there. People who do it from habit, people who could easily be incentivized onto public transport, people who could be car sharing. There's got to be an enormous amount that can be done just by encouraging them to think about it. Because I think in Camden, the fact that we have 9% is really extraordinary. Some of these are people who live in Barnet, driving to places in Barnet as well, which I think is people that you probably can go and target and communicate with and find out what services they need quite easily. There's 17,500 people who drive within Barnet to work. And there are actually 13,000 who drive into Barnet from outside of Greater London. And I think whatever you can do to just make them stop doing that would be excellent.
You know they've ceased bus services from Hertfordshire into London, haven't they? They're closing those bus routes.
Closing down the buses from the buses that cross the border from Hertfordshire into North London are being stopped because no one's going to subsidise them. So they're being cancelled.
This is Hertfordshire buses. Yes. I've been involved in the campaign.
So there's no. Isn't the difference in transport to work between Camden and Barnet?
Sorry.
Camden is better served by public transport.
Yes, it can't make a big difference as well, but I just think the difference is so great. There must be some really soft targets in there, people who are doing it kind of just by habit, because there's a parking space at work and all of those kinds of things. Because there are often easy and harder people to reach when it comes to this. Some people are genuinely stuck driving, basically. One of the worst places, I've got all these maps of London and all the different boroughs and who's driving in, and the place with the most people driving to work borough is Hillingdon, and the reason for that is Heathrow Airport. So Heathrow Airport has a huge number of its workforce driving to work, and part of that is shift work, part of that is the uselessness of the buses and the public transport around there, and part of it is because, you know, even if you wanted to, you couldn't really cycle there because the routes that lead to Heathrow Airport are all motorway-style things. There's an awful lot that, I went there the other day and talked to them about this, there's an awful lot they could do to improve links to the outside and get people not driving to their workplace. It just skews the entire, you can't tell anything about Hillingdon's people because all the statistics for Hillingdon are just swamped by Heathrow. It's really very interesting. Okay, that's enough. I would like us to also have a wider discussion. I can literally talk about this all day.
Most of what you're saying, I agree that we certainly need to do something about the pollution. I mean, every kid I see is coughing, they've got asthma. It just sounds like a lot of taxation, and all that does is it enables, you create elitism. So you get rich people being able to drive, and ordinary people can't drive because I can't drive to central London. I mean, my mother was dying of cancer. I work very, very long hours. It's easier for me to get in the car and to go and often I'm picking her up and everything else. It was, you know, it's costing me an absolute fortune. But, you know, if you're an MP or, you know, you get your expenses paid by your company, that's absolutely fine. And you find that. You go around Regent's Park or anywhere like that, lovely, beautiful cars. You don't see old bangers like mine and stuff like that anymore. And I agree. You know what, I go to Barnet General Hospital for my feet, and I get in the car. It's ridiculous. It's up the road. And the reason I get in my car, it's quick. It's a lot quicker than waiting for, you know, waiting for
263 going full anyway. You can't get
Crowley,
for 3
that was my, that
get on it.
And it's ridiculously expensive. travelling to, yeah, into central London. Cycling, ooh, I've tried, I'm, it is so dangerous. You know, something needs, you need, if you don't mind my saying, you need to look at the whole thing as opposed to, right, there's pollution, let's tax everybody so that they don't drive. Public transport has got to be cheaper and, yeah, more efficient.
So I accidentally left out a really important thing, which is that it is important to put in incentives for people not to drive. But in the course of doing that, like you said, we'll be talking about some new charges here, the licences for workplace parking, the extra charges for diesel cars, and having a congestion charge that covers the whole of London. Now, that would be much less for a trip from here to Barnet Hospital, miles less than it would be, maybe 20p or something, whereas to go into central London, the congestion charge fee will be much higher. But when you raise all this money, you have to spend it on something. And so what I'm going to spend it on is reducing fares. I'm going to cut the fares from outer London so that you pay the same to go into central London from here.
But it's still really expensive. London's my city and I want to be able to enjoy it. Mm. And you know, it cost me £12 to get to town to have a wander around.
Well, that's the point. So now instead, it'll cost you the same as it does if you went from zone one. That's my policy, to flatten the fares so that everybody pays the same to use public transport, because it does make no sense.
But then you get the taxation in place, and I'll give you an example of the Severn Bridge. We'll just charge a toll until we pay for the bridge. But well, the bridge was paid for I don't know how many years ago, certainly, you know, more than I care to mention, but we're still being charged. And that's what happens. So what are they doing with all this money? Mm. And everyone says, oh, it, you know, that we have Barnet Council levying lots of taxes for instance, the parking tickets that they issue, and it goes into a parking fund. Now, they're not allowed to use that for anything else, but they're not ploughing it back into making it. I mean, I'd love for
So the parking revenue account, you have to spend that on improving transport.
Yeah.
And you either spend it on providing the parking spaces, but you always end up with a surplus. And when you have that surplus, you spend it in Camden. I don't know what to do about it, but in Camden we spend it on new cycle routes, we spend it on improving bus stops, we spend it on improving pavements, street lighting, you know, those are things that
we
spend the
parking
revenue account on.
We've got a surplus in Barnet Council in excess of £20 million that they're sitting on, and they... Anyway.
Yes, no, they should be spending it on the system. And that's the key thing. So all the money that we raise from the new taxation is going to be about making the alternatives much cheaper for people in outer London, because I think that's where the money needs to go. We're not going to be cutting fares for people in inner London, but for outer London. And investing more in cycling infrastructure and improving town centres, making it easier to get to places to shop that are nearby to you, rather than going a car to the big shops that are further away.
But the way parking works, sorry guys, I'm really sorry. The way parking works, say Brent Cross, you can drive there and it's free. You come to your local high road, you've got to fuff around with mobile phones or credit cards.
We don't currently have the power for parking at Red Cross, because it's going to be a new town centre, so they need to charge for parking at Red Cross.
Yeah, and today for me, today was like the I was in Seven Sisters. I didn't realize actually they have actually closed the ticket office. It's like there was one ticket machine working, the other two were broken. I think that's like, yeah. That's
and sorry. That should come from kids. We should be educating children to walk. And use public. That's where I think it should start. You know, my mum always drove us around, so I drive around. Whereas if you're taught to, I mean, parents around schools, it's a nightmare. Let kids walk to school. You have to live within a certain distance of our primary schools now. Mm. And yet our roads are clogged up with mums in their great big 4x4s dropping off
in their pyjamas.
Sorry,
it's got to be to be reducing the costs for other things. We want people to be paying less, and it does cost a fortune to own and run a car. I mean, it's cheaper to take the one trip, but you're already covering your insurance, your car tax, you're buying the car. Petrol's getting cheaper, exactly. So the individual trips cost less by car, but ultimately it's cheaper to have a travel car in London, and it should be cheaper to do that and more convenient to do that.
I think
London, I believe, is the most expensive public transport in Europe. I think I'm not sure. Don't quote me on that, but I wanted to ask you a few questions, actually.
Just one, please, Phil.
Okay, one question. Well, anyway, with pricing, have you considered having a, for the first 3 miles or so, 3 kilometres, having an extra higher charge to prevent people driving for short distances. Because the catalyzers, apparently, they only start working after three. They only start working after 3 kilometres.
That's a really good idea.
Another thing is, what about
more short trips?
And what about some charging people in proportion to how much they earn?
Yeah.
Then you'll be hitting all these 4x4 drivers.
So you know my first ever campaign was against 4x4s, against urban 4x4s.
There was one, yeah.
Yeah, but that was me. And I sat there on Richard and Judy's sofa in 2004 saying, you know what, one of the problems with these cars is they're all diesels, and diesels emit more nitrogen dioxide, and I'm trying to explain this on Richard and Judy. I was a little bit ahead of my time there, but people did recognise that they were big and dangerous, and the climate change side of things was interesting too. We did have some success.
Okay, can you actually ban 4x4s in London in the first place?
You have trouble defining them. So we ended up bringing in, Ken Livingstone agreed to bring in something called the CO2 charge, which was basically a higher congestion charge for the vehicles with higher engine sizes if they were older, or higher CO2 if they were newer. But that didn't tackle the diesel problem, and we did point that out.
There are lots of problems with those vehicles which are non-emissions. If you are unfortunate enough to get hit by one of these things, your chances of surviving are only a fifth of the chances you'd have if you were hit by a car, because as you know, cars are designed to kind of spill pedestrians gracefully, if such a thing were possible, whereas the 4x4s are just like a wall of metal.
Rosalind has something to say?
One thing that's a bit deceptive is that TfL in Sweden did some research on some of the small dieselgate cars, and so big is this fraud that some of these small cars are emitting more than a bus or an HGV. So it's not necessarily what you see is what it's emitting. The fraud is right across the board, and it includes petrolgate and also even some hybrids. So there are, God knows, I mean, I'm trying to get TfL to tell me how many illegal cars there are out there that are still driving around. You know, possibly, you can imagine en masse emitting, you know, these small cars emitting as much of a bus. So yes, buses are an issue, HGVs are an issue, but to have one person in a small car emitting the same as a bus or an HGV is just scandalous. Mm-hmm. And you know, I feel extremely strongly that we have to ban diesel throughout London. I think John Vidal has said, you know, he's suffered himself from heart issues to do with air pollution. And he said the only way you are going to bring it down to legal limits is to ban diesel and ban some of the high polluting petrol as well. And you know, I feel for the people who are consumers, but they need to join a class action against the companies in Europe who petitioned and lobbied the EU because they had invested a lot of money in diesel. They wanted to max out their investment, and they persuaded the EU to go along with it, even though our government, the EU, the other governments in the EU knew that this was highly toxic to human health. And I think it's completely, you know, I'm afraid that, you know, those are the people that should be sued. That, you know, that if you have bought a diesel car thinking it is green, go and join a class action against these companies. But, you know, for the people who have not bought cars, and actually UK-wide, more than half of the UK population do not own a driver's license. So, you know, I mean, that does include children as well. But you know, I think we have to decide what's the basic human right: to breathe clean air or to drive whenever, wherever you want. And, you know, I think that breathing clean air, like being able to walk, you know, I think one should be able to walk around safely. I mean, I think that's a basic human right as well that needs to be. I mean, I don't think it's enshrined in the human right law, but I mean, that to me is something so basic And you know, I personally believe, John, I probably disagree. I don't. I think we have to ban these. I think it just has to be outright like that. And you know, it's very unfortunate for those people who bought into that, but they have been defrauded by these companies, these car lobbies, you know, car manufacturers.
I wanted to. I mean, I obviously I'm extremely sympathetic to what you say, Rosalyn. But I want to change the focus slightly and ask a slightly more provocative question, and that is to ask you, of the two leading mayoral candidates, who gets this, and what should we be saying to them?
What, these two? So I was at Hustings the other day, the first one, where they all turned up. We had an environment Hustings, which Rosalind came to in Shoreditch last week, but neither Zach nor Sadiq came to that.
Neither of them?
No. So it was Byron Hustings, organised by a range of environmental groups, and they sent substitutes who were a bit useless, I thought. And then last week, there was the first Hustings which everyone came to.
Yeah, I saw you on TV there.
Yes, exactly. And neither of them showed much there, actually. If you look up Zach Goldsmith's 10-point plan for London, it's what he's put out so far, not his full manifesto, it says, I will tackle air pollution by putting standards on HGVs. That was it, wasn't it? That's all he said, isn't it? It's a really small, tiny part of the problem that he said he will tackle so far. And he doesn't seem to particularly want to talk about either road pricing or drastic action on diesel vehicles or anything to drastically reduce fares. He said he won't reduce fares because he doesn't want to harm Transport for London's investment. And you see, the thing what I'm proposing to do is fare payers contribute 40% of Transport for London's investment at the moment, and car drivers pay 2.5%. So I'm proposing to shift it a little bit. So I'm going to recoup the loss from car drivers. Sadiq Khan said something which drives me absolutely wild, which is that 10,000 people a year in London die from air quality. You don't die from air quality, you die from air pollution. And I tried to point this out, but you know, using that phrase, I mean, poor air quality is a phrase. You don't die from air quality though, it's the wrong term, and that really wound me up. And so, yeah, he waffled on about various things that are not particularly effective either. Neither of them want to say, as Rosalind does, and as I do, that we need to reduce traffic in London and we need something quite drastic to do it.
I do understand from what I'm reading on Twitter that Zach Goldsmith would like to ban diesel, but the Conservative Party are holding him back.
Let
it. But whether that's true or not, but that did come from somebody who would know about that. He certainly hasn't come out.
Sian's like leading candidate on this, and yourself. So we only have two votes, so it's not really much point worrying about Zach and Steve.
Yeah, Zach Goldsmith used to edit the Ecologist magazine. Mm-hmm. I used to subscribe to that magazine, and it was very good, very useful source of information. Probably an awful lot. I think we were in it, 4x4 campaign. We were spreading it, things like that. Probably where I learned a lot about air pollution. So it's not like he doesn't know, but he hasn't put together a programme that's really going to deal with it. And I think possibly the fact that his answers were a bit mumbly at the hustings when it was brought up might be, like you say, that sort of conflict in his head. Like, he knows what he should be saying, but he's not allowed.
I think also, everybody has a chance to influence the candidates, even Sian, because most of the candidates have only come up with an action plan, not their full manifesto. So it might seem like everything at the moment is set in stone, but actually it's not.
No.
Everything is open to change. So if, you know, Sian has got very good write-ups for her hustings at LSE.
Yeah.
And, you know, anything can happen. You know, it's quite a long time to the election, but, you know, anybody is open to pressure. Before they come up with their final manifesto.
It is true. We've got, we're going to bring our first draft, our consultation draft of the Green Party manifesto to the London Fed meeting. So if you're a member, please come to the London Fed meeting on the third Monday of this month. You can see the very first draft of our manifesto in proper form. It's, you know, we're still writing it. We're still meeting campaign groups. We're still adding new bits and pieces to it. We've obviously written most of it by now. But that consultation will last for a month. We won't bring the final draft to London Fed until the March meeting, at which point it'll be signed off and off to the printers. But there is still time to influence us.
Do you think it's what's you think the cutoff point about March, just the beginning of March, or
it's about 3 weeks till you can really make a big change, I think. So by the sort of second week of March, we'll be consolidating the responses we've had and making the final draft ready for them. It's all very tight, but we will get it done.
Thanks for
doing
the game.
Conrad.
My name's Conrad. I'm acting as secretary for a group called the Air Quality Alliance that folded around Nikki Gavrock. One of the things that's come up again and again is measurement. The question, I'm not a binary kind of a person. There's been talk about grading vehicles in terms of what they should be charged for emission. And portable emissions testing, it seems to me, is the way to go in terms of actually getting proper estimates of what each class of vehicle in each year is emitting, so that you can then start using automatic number plate recognition to assign charges to those. But when it comes to, I mean, both of you, I think, mentioned sort of citizen science monitoring in the area, and one of the things we're desperately aware of is a range of monitoring devices around. Some of our folks are using the thing called the Air Quality Edge, which is notoriously unreliable. There are devices at around the £2,000 mark, which start to become quite reliable. The things that deliver change are using are around that class. And of course, the thing on Marylebone Road cost about £100,000 if you're prepared to go for really accurate air monitoring. So how do we solve this problem about getting air monitoring, which not only gives us dramatic results, but actually gives us truthful results that we can trust scientifically?
Yeah, I mean, one of the things I really want to do is to have real-time monitoring on street corners. I want to have...
It costs you about £2,000 per machine.
Yes, exactly. So I want to start doing that. But I think if you start to buy them in bulk as a city, you can probably bring the cost down that way, and that will help bring it down to campaigners as well. And I think that's a service we can do. I'd really like to have them in every legible London post. You know, the ones, you know, the legible London, the black monolith things that sort of say where you are and things like that. If we could incorporate air pollution monitoring and a readout of what the air pollution was in some kind of colour code, that would be amazing. It would add quite a lot to the cost of that, actually. I think I'm not sure if that can go into plans yet, but I think in a certain number of places we should be displaying, like the one at Marylebone Road ought to be displaying what it's reading at the time.
Supplementary. One of the other problems is that we're discovering that the way that air pollution propagates, the mathematical models you need to be able to estimate between the various points, it's sadly deficient. There are places that, according to the averages, should be saying thus, but they're saying thus when you go and measure them locally. And there are canyoning effects amongst high buildings and things like that.
Yeah.
So we still need a lot of research and mathematical modelling into understanding all of this.
Yeah, so this is common sense, actually. The local campaign in Highgate, Dartford Park, sprung up because there's a rat run through the ward, and it's a rat run which has terraced houses that are three and a bit stories high on either side. And the people there came to me on their local council, and they said, we think, you know, we think the air pollution is going to be worse here because of the canyon effect, and they just worked this out for themselves. The modelling, the TFL modelling, did not say that it was going to be that high. But when we measured it, sure enough, it was 55 on the street and 45 on the next street. So the microclimates that you get that's why the metal modelling is really good. And the diffusion tubes that people use, they are the same things that the councils use. They aren't the reporting to the EU standard of
monitoring.
Just NO2. And that's quite accurate because it's a measure of the average concentration of NO2
over a
period
of
a month. And that is fairly accurate. But for real time monitoring, for the moment by moment stuff that can go up above 200-250, you've got to spend a bit of money on at the moment. And hopefully you can bring it down if we decide to buy a lot of it. But yeah, I don't know where I'm getting the money from.
Andrew.
Yeah, I'm going to say a question. Having a look, thank you for thinking this. This is the only neighbourhood in Barnet with no known high pollution levels. About 50 yards down there, it is one of Barnet's only two. Monitoring devices, which has recorded nitrogen dioxide levels, annual average nitrogen dioxide levels above WHO recommended maximum every year since it was installed in the late 1990s. Barnet Council's only reaction to being campaigned on us against this was to leave the King's College under their scheme. That was only it. So I'm pleased to hear from you today. There are things that can be done. Well, obviously, lovely with buses, but less routine buses is good. Your idea of getting local businesses to campaign on the issue is great. It's nice when there are things we could actually do in Barnet, to improve the situation. But my question is this: between here and Westdown, the next shopping area, there's about six housing developments going on. New flats being built, and that's just in this one street. And all over Barnet, there's developers, there's Red Cross, there's Mill Hill, there's several areas that are being regenerated as fast as the council can sell the land off for bits. What should be our attitude to parking and transport issues for all these new developments to deter those people from travelling by car?
Okay, parking standards are really, really important in this, and they vary enormously. I don't know what Barnets are, do you know?
What do you mean by that?
Oh, so when you build a new development, how many parking spaces are you allowed?
0.8
per dwelling.
Yeah.
That's quite high. Where
do you bring stand on that?
We want them to be as low as possible. In Camden, we've managed to persuade the council's new local plan to include zero car parking spaces in all new developments. We think that's right because it doesn't stop people who own a car from buying a house in Camden. They just have to buy one of the ones that already exist. New developments should not be adding to the problem, and that's Camden's attitude now. It's got to go for the inspector, but we think we'll get there. Islington have had a zero car policy for a while now, and that's working really well. But out of London, again, it's not such a different place. Sutton have got very good standards. I think theirs is something like 0.3. I think Sutton have about 0.3, and if you look at Bexley or somewhere over there, they're allowing two car parking spaces per home. So you've got this variation between boroughs that are not that different actually. And if you look at the maps that I do of people who car ownership and who drives and things like that, these are not that different boroughs. But one of them is moving in the right direction, and one of them isn't. So we should have the fiercest parking standards almost throughout London, I think.
So when the planning applications come in, we should be. Our response should be fewer car spaces or...
Yeah, absolutely. Especially if they're near public transport. Anywhere on this road,
exactly.
It's going to have decent public transport access. So,
one of the big stories in the paper last week was a protest about a big development taking place in Barnet where the developers were intending to charge £2,000 for a parking space within that new development, and this had a huge headline on
25,000.
£25,000.
Yeah, that's how much they were. Yeah. So that's an interesting. That's another. This is a private developer.
There wasn't one parking space for that home.
I don't know. They're
trying to create a market in there, and that's interesting actually.
But I think there's quite a lot of resistance for that sort of, the parking stuff because it just pushes the problem onto. Where other people are parking existing. So if the new builds don't have parking spaces, then all the people living beside are going, my God, I could park outside my house, but I can't anymore.
Yeah, both workplace parking levy and a car-free housing policy depend on having universal coverage of controlled parking zones for residents. Because that's how you have a car-free housing development. Like you say, if you just don't build any, it doesn't mean people won't bring cars. You have to not give the people who live in that development the ability to get a resident parking permit. That's how they do it in Islington and Camden. But unless you have controlled parking zones in the first place, you can't do it. So you need to bring those in first.
Does that help bring the price of those new development properties down?
I don't think so.
I don't think estate agents would even slightly consider taking money off the price if it doesn't have a parking space. I mean, they do. Developers love to build parking spaces because they think it means they can charge more. But I don't think it works in the other direction. It's like, you know, when the petrol, when the price of things goes down, you don't really see them dropping the prices at the pumps as quickly as they should.
Okay, well, ladies and gentlemen, I think that if there's no other urgent comment
Adele,
or question,
Adele,
shout Adele.
Hello. Following on from these, one of the biggest developments here is the Brent Cross Shopping Centre. It fits in with a lot of the things you're saying. So my question is going to be, how are either or both of you going to help the people there and help the problem there? And the shopping centre is going to bring 29,000 new cars, which aren't from people locally. We've got our own shops, so this is a different problem. It's bringing people in for this mega shopping centre. There are already big roads there. There are all schools around it, so it touches on that issue as well. As part of building it, there's a whole estate, the Whitefields Estate, which is being demolished. People are losing their homes. So I'm hoping maybe for some commitment from either or both of you. How are you going to help the people there during your campaign when you could be drawing attention to this?
Yeah, I mean, as that, you have the power to call in developments like that. And I think, I don't know what the history of this is exactly.
It was turned down by the previous government. It was turned down for all of these kind of issues. Then the Conservative government came in and gave permission for it to be built. But there were certain things that they weren't supposed to do, and gradually they're getting planning permission for things that weren't permitted at first. So they're gradually adding, you know, building over space that children play on at the moment. It's gradually being whittled away. Places where they're supposed to be just, you know, townhouses, it's being turned into blocks of flats. So it's gradually becoming a bigger and bigger development. And the other thing is like for people losing homes they bought who can't afford to buy a new one, or people living with secure tenancies who are offered insecure tenancies, so the gradual erosion of rights, so they're quite a few things.
Yeah, and we can both support you in campaigning and raising the issues. We can also help. My experience as a councillor, Stephen's as a stalwart of the community who understands how councils work, we can both help to put in things like freedom of information requests. You need to find out things to help, particularly the leaseholders. Who are on these places that are being demolished and things like that, we can help you, so do let us know. When it comes to the future planning, if we're on the Assembly or if we're the Mayor, we can definitely help. So if it's being done in phases and there's still phases to go that haven't got permissions yet, we can influence that. In terms of the regular car park to do with the shops, we don't have the legal, we can only tax at the moment workplace commuter parking. There's no provision at the moment to charge supermarkets for their giant car park. It's a right we'd have to campaign to the government to have, because I think it would be really good. Some of these giant car parks are not used. You've seen the size of the some of the car parks in American malls.
Mm-hmm.
They are built for the day on which most people come, i.e. Black Friday, which is the day after Thanksgiving in America. And 99% of the time, these car parks are not used. And you've got similar issues here. And if we can persuade some of our supermarkets to reduce their car parking, the size of their car parks, you know, so that they aren't just catering for the peak and they do more to encourage public transport, and maybe give up some of that land for housing, that would be really, really good. At the moment, we don't have any taxation powers in that description.
It might be nice for one or both of you to promise to go and do a site visit at Red Cross, because one of the biggest developments in Europe. And it's a huge issue for London. And there's a couple of very active campaigns on Brent Cross which you could draw on their knowledge and their experience. So, Adele, you would be happy to liaise about that,
yes,
wouldn't you?
Yes.
Yeah.
And that's a very interesting idea that the housing could be built on the car parks.
Yeah, infill as opposed to demolition. That's very much.
There's 6.8 million parking spaces in London. If you times that by the minimum parking space, it comes to 78.5 kilometres square.
Whoa.
So imagine all that space. I'm not saying all of it could be housing, because obviously some of it's on street, some of it's off street. but it is a massive amount of land when we're worrying about, you know, having space for housing. There is a lot of land out there, and if you create the right circumstances for people to be able to walk and cycle, because another thing we haven't mentioned about the outer boroughs is that 60% of car journeys are under 1 mile in the outer boroughs. So we're not talking, I think a lot of people think most people have their cars for long distance, but actually that's not true. These are cyclable, walkable distances if we had the safe infrastructure for people to feel comfortable doing those things.
There are a few people wanting to say something before we close. Philip.
Do you have any thoughts or plans about capacity? Because we're talking about discouraging people from cars, but for me the problems with the public transport are the prohibitive costs involved, which obviously you've mentioned what your plans are for that. And it was interesting to hear about the people driving into Barnet for work, because I know a lot of them, because a lot of them have been priced out, moved up various towns, up the A1, and driving back in because it costs the season ticket from Letchworth Garden City costs £500 a month. So most of the people I know that have moved out use their cars because they would have to pay parking at the train station and then the cost of the fare. My sister only used to use the train because she used to work for the tube and get a 75% discount, which was, you know, made it affordable for her. But in terms of, you know, the housing developments coming up, beside me at New Barnet, you can barely get a seat. Certainly at Oakley Park, you cannot get a seat. By the next stop, you can't hardly get on. And I would imagine it's...
That's trains becoming, into London, is it?
Trains? Yeah.
Trains from Moorgate.
It's becoming the same on the Northern Line. I haven't travelled the Northern Line for a long time. But, you know, whenever I get on the train or the tube, to me, I'm just like... It can't get any busier. Then I do it 3 months later and I'm like, oh my God, it has got busier. And yeah, just something, you've reminded me about the congestion charge. You know, when that came in, that, for me, it was unfair because, like you said, Mr. Mercedes could come and go as he pleased, but little Miss Fiesta couldn't. And to me, that congestion charge should never have come in until such a time that it could have paid for free public transport. And, you know, subsidised it like that. But yeah, my main question, sorry, so God, is about the capacity and what you see there. And obviously there's the cross-borough transport, which is why people use their cars as well, because to get from, you know, to get an easy 5 mile journey, you have to get 3 buses across borough. It just doesn't work. But yeah, sorry.
Should we get all the questions because we're going to finish up? Then we'll do the monologue.
So I was knocking on doors in Edgware. Anyway, this guy, he says, in the town hall, he says, oh, you knocked on my door, I remember you. And he's from the Residents Association. And they are very panicky because there's a composting facility next to them, upwind from them. And I was very over-the-top polite to them. And Kevin Cressland was like, these guys are just NIMBYs. They're just, you know, privileged. They live in Edgware. They've got this lovely fresh air. What's their problem complaining about the smell from the compost facility? And this is your compost facility, Sean. So what are you going to do about the ill health effects? These people can't go outside because the smell of compost is inside.
So what?
Any other comments?
Well, we're talking about money and about how to fund things, you know. Surely the fact that anything between £30 billion and £80 billion, whoever you believe, is in tax years, is avoided, not collected by one means or another. If you had that money, that would be enabled any other number of schemes that we could plan. If we once you had that money, and we need to fight against tax havens, but this is something more global, not to do with transport, well, indirectly to do with transport, if you can't finance things.
Anyone else?
I was hoping you maybe could enlighten me on this. I heard a rumour that there was plans for the free bus passes for under-16s that was potentially being removed in the future. I don't know if you know anything about that. And I was wondering as well if what kind of policies there are for younger people, you know, should free transport be extended, in line with policies with education. So young people are expected to be in education until they're 18 now. Should they still get free bus passes up to that age, maybe even later to help students? What is, you know, to, and that's a good long-term investment perhaps as well, if you get people young using that kind of transport, that kind of becomes a habit for life.
All right, over to you two.
Oh, one more.
Well,
I won't win this time. Following on from this, it's reminded me, both of my sons are students, one's at university, the other one will be going. One started at university in London, and he's moved to Southampton for a variety of reasons. But two of them, one was the capacity on the tube for him going down to UCL. It was almost impossible to get onto the tube in rush hour. So how that will be dealt with if we're encouraging people back onto public transport. So that's on the capacity again. Also, the tubes are very expensive. Their bus pass at school is still expensive. One tube doesn't really cover that. The other big problem he had, and that my younger son will have because he wants to go to university in London, was the cost of student accommodation was well above a student loan. I'm on a low income, and at that time, they couldn't even get him accommodation. He had to live at home, but he wouldn't have been able to afford to go to university if he had gone to another town, say, and had gone into accommodation. So the government now getting rid of the maintenance grants for low-income parents, that's a problem. But I'd like to ask what you're going to do about for students and about student accommodation in London, which is a huge problem.
May I squeeze in one more?
Okay.
Sorry, I've just come in. I've been stuck on the 134 bus.
Oh,
but I thought seeing the morning on my way to Finchley, I might as well. I don't know if anybody else has noticed, but each time the Green Party talks about immigration and say we should let immigrants in, some people always counter that and say, but the Green Party is about population control and not overcrowding. So I'm interested to know how to answer to those sorts of criticisms.
I've got a quick cheeky one. Cut your losses. I wouldn't trust Hathwick even with designing a bridge. The Alexander Dennis 400H is probably the best one to go for. Forget the rest.
Not like Hathwick near it.
Right, it's up to you how you comment on any and all of those comments.
Okay, one, two,
see what's
three, four.
And I'll finish up
with
you guys.
You don't.
Please come a compost.
Generously. Happy to come a compost. We've got a big compost heap in our own backyard, and I'm happy to say it doesn't really smell.
We've already had a look at this one. We start working out just about the
minute. It's all the way up.
Phil, thank you. You were raising the point about billions and tens of billions of pounds in avoided taxes. And this is part of a bigger picture in which corporations are let off paying taxes, allowed to squirrel away in tax shelters, while we're presented with a regime where there's no money. There's no money to invest in public services. In particular, there's no money to invest in public transport. As you spotted, this is all bollocks. There's plenty of money available if we want to go and get it, and we need to turn around this climate of starving public goods and rewarding ourselves and enriching our nation with good public services and good public transport. This, I think, would tackle many of the questions you're asking about, isn't it so expensive? Yes, it's far too expensive. You're asking about the young, and you too, Nathan. Personally, this is Green Party policy. Personally, I don't think that the free bus passes for the under 16 should go, or for uni students should go when they finish studies. I think for the time being, we should give free bus passes to everyone who still has to live at home with their parents, up to at least the age of 30. It's a scandal.
That's a policy for the parents, for the children.
One of the suggestions here is free buses. That's one of the suggestions that came out of the summit.
Yeah, I leave you with something the mayor of Bogota in Peru said a couple of years ago. He said, developed country is not one where the poor can drive, but where the rich use public transport.
Oh, yeah. I agree with that one.
Yeah, that's fantastic. On the way upwards from the last question there, that we don't have a population policy actually in the Green Party. We do have issues with the consumption of individual people. We know that population rises do lead to increases in consumption, and we want to cut that down per person. We don't have a policy that caps population. Somebody asked me, there was a story in the Evening Standard a couple of days ago, where they asked me about that, you know, Green Party, do you not want to stop London's population going above 10 million? And I said, basically, yeah, I think, you know, London can get to 10 million, we can fit in lots of people, we should have all the refugees we can handle, I don't want to stop us being an open city. Once you start going above 10 million, I think the answer is not to cap London's population, but it's a sign then that we're overheating in the rest of the country. So I think we ought to be encouraging other cities to grow as well as London. But there's no way I'm going to cap the population. We can live far more frugally in terms of resources than we currently do. We can live much more densely than we currently do. And when it comes to things like refugee policies, those are just human rights obligations. So we have to take people who are asylum seekers. We have to give people a home when they're fleeing war. It's just what we have to do, and we'll find routes and all of those kinds of things. And the policies we have to cut our own consumption are what's most important there. Students, we are doing some work on the cost of student accommodation. The Young Greens are doing a load of FOIs. So we're going to be releasing a report in a couple of weeks' time. We're going to be working on the concept of the student living rent and doing something about that on London level. So watch this space, because we are concerned about it. The reason Ken Livingston brought in the it runs up to 18 if you're still in education.
Oh, does it?
Bus pass. Yeah. And made it for the buses is because that's exactly what he wanted. He wanted people to get used to where the buses run and using the buses so that they'll carry on doing it. And part of the reason for that, he doesn't give them a tube, is because the tube is getting overcrowded. So we have got issues there. We have to be taking the money that we raise from fare payers and drivers and investing it in new capacity on all the lines. And that includes taking in the rail franchises, the rail lines that you were talking about. We have to be running those on a TfL type basis, the way that we run the overground and increasing the capacity there. The overground's made an enormous difference where it runs. And we need the same for all the radial routes that go out into outside of London as well, which are rubbish, especially in South London. We've got some terrible frequency on some of those lines. And until you get up to that sort of 8-minute gap, the sort of called metro frequencies, where people can just turn up and not have to rely on the timetable, you don't see huge increases in people using it. But as soon as you've got that kind of service, the amount of people using it exceeds the predictions, which is the overground has done exactly that. People said so many people will use it, and actually it's about, like, I don't know, like 80% that they would use it. So it's very exciting. Other taxes, the fact that we can't afford to do things because the companies are avoiding taxes. There's a fantastic article you may have read in The Guardian by a man called Evgeny Morozov.
Sorry?
Evgeny Morozov. I'm saying that as it's spelled. And it's in The Guardian yesterday or the day before, and it talks about how Uber gets to do what it's doing, which is trying to drive the black cabs out of London, trying to take over the entire private hire market. Not because it's making it brilliant at capitalism, but it's making loads of money from doing it. It's just the best in the market. It's being subsidised like crazy by hedge funds and companies like Google, companies like Amazon, who are not paying their flipping taxes and therefore have loads of money to subsidise loss leaders like Uber to aggressively take over markets like the ones we've got. So we've got a real problem there. A platform like Uber could be, and the Finnish are trying this actually in Finland, a platform like Uber could be something where you just ask your, where's my nearest bus and tube? and everything can be displayed in a wonderful way. And okay, yeah, there's no bus or tube, it can show you a car, or where the nearest car club is, or look at the hire bikes. You can have a fully integrated citywide app. But instead, it's Uber who are taking over that market. And the reason we can't afford in London to develop something like that and make it work properly is partly that, because we haven't got enough taxes. But yeah, we are going to be taking over some of the business taxes quite soon, and that should enable us to do more things like differential taxes for larger businesses and things like that, if we can persuade the chancellor to resolve those things, and that will make a bit of difference. But they're not paying their corporation taxes to the central government. That's, you know, that's more of a disgrace.
Yes. Wonderful. Guys, listen, this is a really, really, really important and far-ranging subject, and we could, and I hope we will, speak about it again. But for now, I'm going to suggest we bring this meeting to a close with a couple of announcements and exhortations to further action. We have a big campaign ahead of us. It's a wonderful campaign, in as much as we can go all out for green policies, knowing that it's an and/or election, for which it's really worth putting in a lot of effort. So a couple of the announcements. One would relate to the tube, to the air monitoring project, which Phil is going to lead.
I'm leading that.
Do you want to say one sentence
yes,
about that?
Well, just let me try and express myself as quickly and concise as possible. I'd be very pleased if people could come to me, and if they're interested in taking part in this, and we can write down emails. Sentence number one. Sentence number two, the Brent Cross Coalition, which you spoke about before, they're having a meeting tonight, and that's why I couldn't go to their meeting, because I'm here. And hopefully they're going to be discussing about putting up our air pollution tubes, which I'm holding in this bag here. And I've got 10, so we need to get these out and work out where to put them so we can make the best use of them around Brent's Cross. And also, anywhere else you can think or you think would be a good idea. So, for example, schools possibly around there.
Hadley Wood, Jacos, where all the buses come in.
Yes. I'm going to be a NIMBY. Yeah. I was going to say Daddy
and
A,
Phil,
because it's a rat
and run. Phil will be in touch with Stephen, who's done this project in Hampstead, and getting advice. So is that right then, Phil? Can we say thank you for that now?
Yes. Can I just mention one other little thing?
One other
very
thing.
Quickly. Now, I spent most of today running around, well, this morning. I met 40 shopkeepers in Finchley who have not heard of TTIP. because of the public. Anyway, what is it? I've got a petition here to sign to make Barnet become TTIP free, which means basically to give any other campaigns of support so we get more discussion about it. Because we haven't, there's no discussion on TTIP, we've got to do something about this. It's better than doing nothing. Okay, so I've got it here, so please come to sign the thing if you haven't.
Thank you, Phil. That's fantastic. Your initiatives are really valuable, and I'm looking forward to all the membership getting behind them. Next week is our AGM. Is that right, Andrew? So next week's our AGM on a Monday night, and we will be talking about all kinds of things. Is there any particular point that you would like to make about that now, Andrew?
We need new officers, activists who are willing to take on specific roles. Particularly, we need Stephen needs a campaign manager or Barnet campaign manager, will benefit from that. So we need a new chair, we need a membership secretary. We've got two leaflet coordinators, haven't we? We need to officialise their appointments. They're quite a lot of roles that need filling, so if anyone wants to do a bit more, come along next Monday to St Mary's Church Hall and let us know what you can do.
Right. David has an announcement.
Well, I just have an appeal, which is my regular appeal as treasurer of Barnet Green Party. We're always short of cash to support all our campaigns. Some members are very generously making a small monthly donation of a few pounds a month directly through their bank, and that's a wonderful thing that helps us. So if anybody wants details of our bank, I'm very happy to give that to you. And all donations go towards funding all our campaigns, such as the air pollution campaign and other things that we'd like to do coming up to the London elections. Thank you.
Thank you. If you are not on our circulation list, please speak to Andrew to get yourself on the email list so you get updated about all the activities. Please pull in behind Phil's, well, I shouldn't say Phil's, it's our air pollution monitoring project, which Phil is kindly coordinating. And please note that our next speaker is on the 22nd of this month, and it will be about the Peace Tax Initiative, which will be launched in Parliament the following week. Sean Dolan, who is leading the campaign, will be coming to speak to us about that. And please remain active, and I hope that you have enjoyed this evening.
Oh, yeah.
Thank you, Tom.
Thank you. Thank you, guys. Okay.
Simply that I've been offered a job in Warwick, so I'm going to be moving out of the area within the next month.
Oh, right. Okay, guys, thank you so much. And yeah, please tweet and Facebook.